Baton Rouge lies awake at night, doesn't sleep for days. I guess he's carrying something that the pillars can't take away. I feel just like him, except for me it's double. Baby, I got you in your trouble. Where your trouble?
Mike, number one, his whole thing was music. Mike had a really good ear for hearing music, but he had a unique way of getting everybody together to actually do it.
Well, Tessie loves excitement, can make a dull moment a thrill. She does whatever she wants, then puts...
The first thing about Michael, he loved music. He thought it was a great thing. He put it above everything else as a system, and you could tell it was it was like bright to him, as opposed to all this dark nonsense.
Well, you're trouble. I used to not need nothing, but now trouble is all I need.
He was loud, obnoxious, rude, but all in a good way. If Mike Ward was in the room, you knew he was in the room. Every woman that was in the room knew Mike Ward was in the room, too.
New Orleans percussionist Michael Ward lived life on his own terms. He did what he wanted, he said what he wanted, and he played what he wanted. Whether with Harry Connick Jr., John Mooney, Charmaine Neville, or his band Michael Ward and Reward, he had a style all his own. Even though he is no longer with us, to those who knew him and played with him, his spirit lives on.
I wouldn't bet against myself in a poker game.
Legendary percussionist Alfred Uganda Roberts, best known for his work with Professor Longhair, taught Michael Ward how to play.
Yeah, he was very interested in the drums and very dedicated. He'd come around every weekend for sure. Always interested in coming together, doing some playing. He was always beating on the drums, but I think I gave him more of a technique so he could get different sounds from the drum. A lot of the basic rhythms on the conga drum and how to hit it, how to hold your hands, how to tune them. He took it from there, created his own style. And later on, he became a merchant marine. His father was a merchant marine, traveling on the ships, and Michael did that for a while. Yeah, he used to send me pictures of him on the ship, send me a postcard or something like that whenever he would go around Africa or somewhere like that. And he'll bring something back, sometimes musical instruments, and he'll share them with us, talk about things he experienced on the ship.
Ward took this knowledge and experience and put it into his music. He started playing again with his childhood friend, singer Theryl Houseman De Clouet, and together they formed the nucleus of the Reward Band.
He wrote a lot of the things that we all, that's what we based getting the band together for, as far as Michael Ward and the Reward. He'd come up with a lot of the ideas and then I would voice it and write it down. We'd always sit down once or twice a week and have writing sessions where we came up with Ain't No Yachts and You Came and all these songs that we would play live. And he was adamant about that, that we had to have some type of live original song catalog. He had great ideas and he was a great catalyst to write with, because he would prick your mind with great thoughts that you could turn into great songs and word couplets. And
Ward also channeled his passion for music into his live performances. Friend Chris Jones worked at the Maple Leaf Bar when Reward was in its prime.
Soul Show Shakedown, just some of the best nights you could ever have. Everybody getting down, whether there's 20 people in the crowd or the rare 200. It was a get down. If there was 12 or 200, every one of them was shaking and getting down and having a ball. The music was something that was a rarity even then, and even more so now, which was soulful music that was written from the heart and played with passion and conviction. It wasn't regurgitative, it wasn't common, it wasn't throwback cover tunes or anything like that. It was the same way people did music back in the mid-70s, something that most people longed for and they don't hear anymore. Everything else is just pale representation of other people's influences, and Mike's music was never that. There was nights they would turn the lights down at the Maple Leaf and there was a great dance party going on where nobody was too concerned about what else was going on in the world around them. It was just a soul shakedown. And so the Reward shows are legendary in my mind.
To keep his sound fresh, Michael Ward was always bringing young musicians into the band, including guitarist Alex McMurray.
At the end of the first day, you know, I'm just like, well, am I going to get to be in the band? Am I in the band? He's like, oh, are you in the band? You're in the band. That's it. You know, it's like, oh, you're the man. But he would just get a vibe off you, and then he would just like say, you know, you're the guy. He was real gung-ho. This was very important to him. You know, the band was real, real important to him. And I don't want to say that he was delusional.
As keyboardist Glenn Hartmann remembers, Ward played classic New Orleans funk.
There's only a few bands that sort of had a true lineage in the tradition. So like almost they were like allowed to really play it. And it's very different for a college rock band to play Sissy Strut and for the Reward to play Sissy Strut. But there's a few other bands that can do it too, of course, like Cyril Neville and his band can do it. And of course the Neville Brothers can do it, and of course the Meters. But this was the bar band. This was the true lineage of the goofy Benny's Shenanigans kind of still occurring. You know, like it hadn't been polished and turned into a commercial product at all. This was just true funk Shenanigans straight from the corner bar, still going on. You know, that's what got lost, because he was the one that held that little glue together.
Guitarist Jonathan Frelich recalls one of the band's infamous haunts.
Benny's Bar. Benny's Bar, so far as I can tell, was a place that, even though it fell down several years later, it looked like it was falling down already. And Benny's Bar was, I don't know, as far as I could tell, it was like a sort of run-down joint that had unbelievably cheap drinks and really interesting mix of people in it. The band played in a room that was just sticks left up there that would have supported walls, but didn't. And there was a lot of drinking and glorious low-life behavior going on. But glorious low-life behavior. And really, it wasn't low-life. That's just a term that we use to describe people having fun.
Musicians loved playing with him. Charmaine Neville explains.
He was very much fun. He was very, very musical. I mean, he had rhythms in him that you just wouldn't even believe. You know, in certain times he'd do things, you know, and it would just be like, wow, did you hear that? As a musician, he was just perfect. I never had any kind of problems with him at all musically. It was just Mike. I think that's what made the difference, because it was Michael. And other percussionists, they may have certain things that they do that's their signature and that kind of stuff. But with Mike, everything was a signature.
Michael Ward played percussion like no one else. Friend and music producer Chris Jones heard him many times.
He's like one of the more unique percussionists, very individual sound that is unlike anybody else's. He doesn't fall into any traps that most percussionists do, like boom, pack, boom, 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 pack, boom, boom. You know, like he never repeated the same thing twice. Musically, that's one thing that struck me from the beginning and was constant throughout, just that he always found inventive ways to stay in the same pocket that other people found common ways to stay in. He never relied on anything easy.
Intense.
Guitar player John Mooney.
I mean, he knew when to lay back, but he would really get up on it too, you know. He had a real knack for just knowing what to play and when to play it. Particularly when we're playing just the two of us. Made some for some very intense gigs, which is great. Man, it was like we were just on the same wavelength. So it was, I mean, for me, it was just like always a joy to play with him. Just, it was intrinsically Michael Ward.
Ward's style blended seamlessly with the chants of the Mardi Gras Indians. He often performed with the Golden Eagles tribe, led by Big Chief Monk Boudreaux.
He was one of the best. He was one of the greatest. It's just in you, something you was born with. Either way you want him to play, that's the way he'll play. I mean, he'd put it in the pocket, or he could pull it up and down. Wherever you want him to be at, that's where he'll go. And that's what made him so great, because, you know, he knew what he was doing. He was playing from his heart. You know, when you play from the heart, you can't beat that. He felt what he was doing.
He knew New Orleans rhythm.
Tracey Freeman is Harry Connick Jr.'s producer, and he worked with Ward on Connick's 1994 funk record, She, and the tour that followed it.
He knew what he had to do, and he could groove like hell when he wanted to. And he could really lay it down. Part of the thing I enjoyed about his playing was that he was never interfered with anything else that was going on. I mean, a lot of times you hear rhythm sections and the drummer's fighting the conga player's playing while the drummer's taking a solo, and not with Mike. He knew what to do. I mean, that basically is just groove.
After 2 years on the road with Connick, Michael Ward returned home, and his presence was duly noted. Charmaine Neville.
I thought he was crazy as roaches on decon, but, you know, that comes from living in New Orleans, you know. We're all kind of like that.
He's a hustler. Keita Ward was, he was a hustler, even at 11 years old.
Theryl Houseman De Clouet.
People didn't understand Mike because he talked so much trash, but he talked the trash to keep you from knowing he was a good guy. He didn't want you to know. He didn't want you to know he'd give you the world if you asked. See, and I knew the good, kind, generous, loyal Michael Ward that I had known from a kid. I've heard a lot of mixed opinions on him, but the real Michael Ward was as good as gold. He'd do anything for you.
You can tell your side of the story. You can talk all night.
No end to people he's helped, musicians, people that just followed the music. He's helped them. I don't know. I can't say enough about Michael Ward, because he believed in me when I didn't really have a strong belief in myself.
Michael Ward extended that kindness to his many friends, including Alex McMurray.
Man, Mike Ward took me shopping. One time we were in Oxford, Mississippi, and I didn't have any clothes, like gig clothes. These guys, they dressed for the gig. Like, you had to have a collared shirt, trousers, not jeans, not sneakers, but shoes. So they're like, you look ragged. You know, you have to, we're trying to put forward a little bit of an image here. Like, we want to be clean. You got to be clean. You know, this is an older guy. And clean was the thing, you know. We're all sitting in Mike's room, seven of us. And I'm like, well, listen, man, I don't got no clothes. I don't got no money for clothes. He's like, I'm taking you shopping. I'm like, oh, yeah, right, you know. We would get back to New Orleans on Sunday afternoon or something. Monday morning rolls around, my phone is ringing. It's like, jump outside. I'm like, what? It's like, we're going shopping. Okay, so I put on some clothes. We go downstairs. We go out to the Target off of Reed Boulevard in the East. And he took me shopping. You know, he bought me like half a dozen silk shirts, some pants. I think the shoes were on me. You know, I had to go buy the shoes on my own. Hey, man. Yeah. Yeah, he took me shopping.
I'm broke. Ain't that the story?
Ward had his own unmistakable style.
Pimp. Big pimpin'.
Bass player Cornell Williams was another member of the Reward Band.
Nah, man, you know, I mean, Mike was cool. One would say he carried himself like Mike. Okay, now what is a Mike? You know what I mean? Only Mike actually knew that, you know? So, you know I mean? As far as what I got out of the way that he carried himself was that he was just cool. You know what I mean? He got out the box when he was provoked, but for the most part, Mike was a cool cat.
Charmaine Neville.
Well, he was a very genuine person. I mean, if he didn't like you, you knew it. You know, he didn't pull any punches. And he was good to just about everybody I ever saw him around. He was good to. He was that kind of person where he was real. There was nothing phony about Mike. Whatever was on his mind, he said it. He didn't bite his tongue. He didn't care who heard him. And he did, you know. He always dressed nice, always. Mike would be, as we used to say, the old men used to say, sharp as a tack. He was always impeccably dressed. As far as the way he carried himself, We actually gave him the name, the Wild Man from Bula Boo, because he was so crazy and so wild. And like I said before, it didn't matter who the people were or what setting the gig was in. We could be playing for royalty or just playing for the kids in the neighborhood. Mike was always the same. He was gonna be Mike. And that was one of the true treasures of Mike, was that him just being the Wild Man from Bula Boo.
Snake and Jake's Christmas Club Lounge, a New Orleans late-night institution, was one of Ward's favorite hangouts. Bartender Elaine Varnes knew him well.
He was a good and generous friend to people. Once you got past this kind of persona of his, and you became friends with him, he would, if he heard you had a problem or anything, he would really go out of his way. Call you up, call other people, make sure whatever is necessary is done. Even if it's not the way you would want it to be handled, he would try. Very funny, but his humor was not for everybody. There were quite a lot of times where we got into fights at the bar. People would think that we were actually really angry at each other. Sometimes he would push my buttons that you have to push back. And he respected that. He kind of liked that give and take. He was one of those people, if you let him, he would steamroll over you. But he appreciated being slammed back.
Ward carried his attitude with him wherever he went. Chris Jones remembers seeing Ward and Harry Connick Jr.'s band playing in front of a very different audience than he normally did.
I saw a show at West Point, New York, which was a real trip. I kept telling my friends, like, we're going to go see my buddies playing with Harry Connick. And we went to West Point, and the auditorium held about 4,000 people. We filed in, we had front row orchestra tickets, and everybody else in the crowd was dressed in their cadet uniforms and military garb. Raymond Weber comes down, he's wearing a woman's bonnet with a tag hanging off of it, and he sits behind the drums and starts the second line beat. There's no one else on stage, and all of a sudden from stage left, here comes this guy with a woman's bonnet's head and a white t-shirt hanging down to his knees with some black ankle boots and black socks pulled up to just below his knees. The shirt that says on the front says Zulu Man. And he comes out and he's second line dancing and pulling his shirt up like he's dancing with a dress up in the front of the crowd and raising up his dress a little bit, you know, to show his knees a little bit more to this cadet, you know, and all these, the general's wives. And I'm like, there's my buddy. Man, they got in so much trouble. The MPs tried to stop the people from dancing. And I remember I sat there and I watched Mike run to the edge of the stage, and he knocked the hat off of MP, just slapped it right off of his head, and the guy turned around and looked at him, and Mike was screaming and pointing his finger at this MP, like, just, no, you don't do that, man. The people want to dance, you let them dance. And I was like, oh my God, we're going to get in a fight in West Point. But he got away with it. He got away with knocking the hat off an MP and yelling at him, berating him, and then the people got to the dance, you know. He got away with a lot of stuff.
Producer Mark Bingham was his good friend.
He just was another New Orleans guy that had like one foot in Tulane and one foot in the hood, and he was kind of like straddling, and the Tulane girls are running between his legs, you know, that kind of guy. The fact that he was so smart and never stopped being a trickster. If he was your friend and you knew him, he was like one way. And then if he was just meeting people, he tended to mess with them. And not in a malicious way or not in a mean-spirited way, but just in a purposefully confusing way and playing stupid and waiting for them to bite and then giving it back to him pretty hard with his incredible intelligence that he had. So been in a lot of strange situations with him at 6 in the morning, and he handled them all pretty well. You know, and it could have got ugly in a lot of cases, and so people forget he was a combination of an instigator and a diplomat, which doesn't make much sense, but I guess that's, Mike didn't make much sense either. So if he hadn't taken a turn down the road he did, he could have been mayor.
Michael Ward was deeply committed to music, and he also embraced everything that came with that particular lifestyle. Jonathan Frelich explains.
What are we talking about? The guy used to get high That's what we're talking about. It was dark, man. He used to get high, and a lot of people came to get high with him. Plus, one thing I like about Mike is that he took responsibility for everything he did, which is a very mature thing. That was ultimately the deal, was, you know, okay, so he walked around being a schmuck some of the time because he was high, or he got high, or he got other people high, but he took full responsibility for it. So far as I saw, and I've seen a lot slimier characters out there running this game, a lot, they used to come around, and he didn't put up with it very long either.
Mark Bingham spent time with Ward when his hard living began to catch up with him.
We're doing this Japanese record, and the lead singer was an acupuncturist. And so, of course, they offered all of us acupuncture. So we were laying on the floor at the studio, and the guy would work on us. So 3 needles, 4 needles, some people, you know, 6 needles if they were sick. So it comes to Mike Ward. Mike Ward lays down. The guy's like, oh, oh. You ever seen Hellraiser? Yeah, Mike Ward looked like Hellraiser 6. The guy had 30 needles in Mike's head. And he has a needle going right through his wrist. Through his wrist. Sticking out the other side. And Mike's lying there. And he goes to the guy, I don't feel a thing. And like, we're all like, you know, you're not supposed to make it. This is not a party atmosphere to get acupuncture. So Mike had more needles in him than this doctor had ever. And so I guess, you know, that gave us an indication that perhaps Mike was not long for this world. And that was, you know, 97 probably, so he made it another 6 months or something after that.
Ward was ill, but in true fashion, he kept it mostly to himself. This put Theryl Houseman De Clouet in a tough situation.
Yeah, because he wouldn't say nothing. He didn't give us no. I said, what did the doctor tell you? Oh, everything went smooth, how? He wouldn't tell me anything other than that, you know? And I knew it wasn't smooth. Serious, whatever it was. But like he told me, when it got into it with him, he said, well, don't question me. Just be my friend and trust me, you know, love me. So I just got off him. And sometime you got to just got to do what your friend wants you to do and be a friend.
Michael Ward passed away on March 18, 1998, but his effect on New Orleans music is very much alive.
Actually, it didn't sink in for a while that he was really gone until that CD was released and I heard him on that CD and I realized he really is gone. You know, I'll never be able to hear this laughter again or hear him whistling so loud that he scares everybody in the place, you know, and yeah.
He was an integrator, and that's one of the great things about the music scene in New Orleans, is that it's truly integrated by age, by race, by religion. So you can have young white people playing with old black people. So if you take a few examples of things that wouldn't have happened without Michael Ward that were important things for New Orleans culturally and, like, if you could say musico-culturally. Klezmer All Stars with Mean Willie Green never would have happened without Michael Ward. First super funk drummer ever to play a centuries-old tradition of Jewish music, something that's been around 500, 600 years at least. So that was a huge thing. So through Willie Green, Michael Ward changes klezmer music for all time. Okay, another example. Jun Yamagichi. Japanese guy gets brought to New Orleans pretty much by Michael Ward, taught all of the funk tunes, becomes maybe the biggest funk guitar player playing now in the city. Japanese guy playing with the Wild Magnolias, okay, Michael Ward did it. Theryl De Clouet in Galactic, Michael Ward. So, I mean, those are hugely different examples, but all very important things in New Orleans music scene.
So I'm gonna remember him because of what he actually had to bring to the music. And that in itself was just unbelievable. To me, I think that his music actually spoke for it all. You could say that he was a very vulgar person and he used a lot of vulgar language and whatnot, but when you actually look beyond all that, you get to really see this real gentle-hearted person that had a big, big heart for the music.
Mike was there. You know, Mike's one of the guys in the Joseph Conrad books that was belonged to the start of time. That's him. He was like out of time. He played, and it didn't matter what century it was. It didn't matter what continent it was. He was there, and he keep that whole drumming tradition alive, which is, God help us now, we have all those new age people banging around in drum circles, and which is just, oh my God. You know, so Mike is the polar opposite of the new age. He ain't no new age guy.
Oh, it's nice to think about him. I mean, it's good feelings. Ain't no yachts in the ghetto.
Ain't no planes gonna fly out the meadow. This program was produced by David Cunyon and Bill Taylor for Jack Beat Productions and the Center for Gulf Coast History and Culture in 2004. The producers would like to thank Dennis Formento and everyone who was interviewed for this project. This program is supported by a grant from the Louisiana Division of the Arts, Office of Cultural Development, Department of Culture, Recreation, and Tourism, in cooperation with the Louisiana State Arts Council, as administered by the Arts Council of New Orleans. My name is Dawn Fabergé. I've been your host. Thanks for listening. We miss you, Mike. They throw a brick, yeah, and then they hide their hand. Hear me when I say my brothers and sisters.
Right around the last part of him being here, right around that time, he was actually coming out with a tune. It was called Kiss Me Where You Like Me. That sort of almost explained Mike. You know?
Ain't no oozies made in the ghetto. Hear me when I say the poor are addicted. The situation gets worse and worse.